mother decide that my sister and I must leave the ghetto? There are many questions I want to ask, but the troubled look on my parents' faces keeps me silent. Each night, I lie awake, terrible thoughts flooding my mind. Each day, I wait for father to tell me that I must leave. There is hardly any food, even at the factory, except for the walk to Schultz. I never go outside anymore, and it's almost spring. I awake one morning with a fever. My head hurts, my body's on fire. Through a mist, I hear voices saying, it's measles, she can't go anywhere. I toss and turn and sweat for days. Once when I wake up, I see mother standing over my cot. She's holding Basha, my little sister Basha, who is dressed in a coat and hat. Say goodbye to your sister. She's going away, says mother quietly. Through a daze, I try to focus on the bundle in a brown wool coat and a white hat with bunny ears. Two big blue eyes and a little face look down at me. What does she want from me? Can't she see I'm sick? I push her away and turn towards the wall. In the morning, I wake up feeling better. The fever seems to have gone. The sun is shining outside. Where is everyone? I look around the room and see that Basha's bed is gone. I run to the wardrobe and see an empty shelf where her things once were. My God, I didn't know she was leaving for good. I didn't even say goodbye. That evening, my parents make sure that my brown suitcase is properly packed, although it is so full that it is hard to close. I refuse to part with my books and my sunflower costume. I beg that they can let me keep them. Now don't be frightened, says father, almost cheerfully. You will have to leave soon, but I don't know when. I go to sleep feeling comforted, but wake with a start. Someone is shaking me. Hurry, hurry, says father. Mother dresses me quickly and hugs me. She says goodbye. Her voice is thick, held back tears. A minute later, father and I are shivering on a misty street. It is dawn. The street is deserted. We walk quickly. I ask no questions, for I know what we are doing. When we hear the rumble of a truck approaching, father pulls me into a doorway. An army truck passes and we continue walking. We stop at a half-burned building. Father pushes at the front door, which squeaks open, and we walk into a dark apartment. It is empty. And father tells me to sit on my suitcase and wait. Don't be scared, he says. I'm waiting for someone. He paces up and down as if rehearsing some speech in his mind. The door squeaks again and I jump. A man walks in wearing the cap and badge of a Jewish policeman. There was a Jewish police force in the ghetto, he ordered. Father greets him with a handshake, then takes a small jewelry box, a pair of leather gloves, and a bar of soap out of his pockets and hands them over. The man opens the jewelry box, and in the dawn light, something sparkles. It's mother's diamond ring. The man stuffs the things into his coat pocket and leaves. Father tells me to be patient. He tells me what I already know, that I'm leaving the ghetto. I sit on my suitcase and keep silent. A rat scurries across the floor, then another. I move my suitcase away from the squeaking rats. And father stops pacing. He shoos away the rats. Sits down next to me on the floor. Where are we, Papa? I ask. Near the ghetto gate, to the other side, he replies, confirming my guess. The policeman returns. It's all fixed, he says. I gave them the goodies. They promised to pretend not to see her. But you know them. They can turn on you anytime. It's a chance you have to take. Good luck. He salutes and leaves. Now, what do you think this policeman did? Yeah? Exactly. He bribed the guards at the checkpoint. for me to walk through. Father is down on the floor again, this time with his head in his hands. After a long moment, he gets up. We're leaving now. Remember what I told you, he says, taking my hand and my suitcase. We leave the building and walk for several blocks. We stop, and Father squeezes my hand tightly. About half a block from us is a busy checkpoint in the ghetto wall. Three soldiers in steel helmets hold rifles as if ready to shoot. They march back and forth in front of the large opening. Several Polish policemen in navy blue uniforms stand by the opening. This is the way out of the ghetto, Slava. You are going to cross that line in a few minutes, Father says gravely. In the pocket of your coat is a false identity card. The name on it is Irena Kominska. It says that you are a Catholic orphan from Warsaw. There will be a woman waiting for you on the other side. She will know you, and she will take you to grandmother's. I'm frozen. I say nothing. Father gives me the suitcase. My hand can barely hold it. When I tell you, start walking, he says. Walk through the checkpoint at a normal pace. Do not hesitate or run. Above all, do not turn around to look at me. He hugs me with tears in his eyes. Now go. I look at him for one last moment, let go of his hand, and begin the longest walk of my life. I try to feel brave as I march towards the checkpoint. As I draw closer, the green German uniforms grow bigger, and the brass buttons of the Polish police posts gleam in the sunlight. I arrive at the checkpoint and begin to walk through. The gendarmes and the police do not appear to notice me. As I walk straight ahead, they turn away. My knees feel weak, and my heartbeat fills my throat, but I keep on walking. A few more steps, and I'm on the other side. I hear shouting beside me. I know who you, little Jewess. I saw you. A small boy in rags points his finger at me. I clutch my suitcase tightly as if it were Father's hand, expecting the worst. All of a sudden, the shouting ceases as a tall woman in a gray suit grabs my hand and pulls me into a side street. She stops for a moment to take my suitcase from me. You can call me Agnes, she says. Don't be afraid. Only then do I remember that Father had said someone would be waiting for me on the other side. We walk quickly now. The beggar boy is left behind. But I feel that the whole world is staring at us. We rush into the train station. Agnes shows the conductor our tickets, and we climb into one of the cars. It is almost empty. A few minutes later, the train pulls out of the station. Agnes sits next to me. She's wearing a gray hat to match her suit. Her eyes are gray too, but large and bright. She's fair-haired. I wonder if she's Jewish. But then I'm fair-haired too. It's my first train ride in 2 years. I sit on the wooden bench taking in things I haven't seen for so long. We pass by open fields and forests, peasants on carts filled with straw, cows grazing in the pastures, and farmhouses with white curtains in the window. The ghetto wall is behind me, but I wish my parents and my sister were here. God knows when I will see them again.